James, is that the same of commercial design? I mean, is it hard work that makes the difference between success and failure, do you think?
Oh, yes. Yes. It's all hard work.
I know you went round that exhibition at the Barbican and were impressed, as I was, by some of the exhibits, in particular, I think, that underground system.
Yes, that was very nice. He had thought that out very carefully. And he looked pretty determined to sell it, and that's important.
But tell me, it's a very big step, isn't it, from having a good idea and even building a prototype to actually getting it in to manufacture? I mean, how big is that step and what does it take?
Well, the idea is about 0.5%. Making a prototype is about 3%. And getting it into production is the rest of it.
Now, I think I'm right in saying that you've just come up not only with that wonderful ball barrow, but also with a new invention, a vacuum cleaner, which I think we'll be able to see with a bit of luck quite shortly. And this is 3 times more effective than the conventional Hoover.
Yes.
But tell me about the problems you've had in actually getting this into production.
Well, the first problem was making it and developing it, and that took about 3 years of research and just simply working away and away and away, building model after model after model. And once I got the system to work, I then went around to manufacturers trying to sell the idea because I didn't have the money to put the thing into production. And of course that took quite a long time. It took about 6 to 9 months.
You say you didn't have the money, but what sort of money is involved in securing the patents, putting it into production?
The patents are a relatively cheap part. We spent about £30,000 up front on the patents. But to put it into production costs about £500,000. That's just to get one made, to get it to this stage. That's before you start promoting it and selling it and so on. So it's a very heavy investment.
Now, I think I'm right in saying that you've actually persuaded an Italian manufacturer to put that into production. Did you not try and sell it here in Britain?
Oh, yes. Yes, I tried 3 British companies and a number of other European companies. The English companies turned it down because it didn't have paper bags. And paper bags are a very lucrative source of income.
Perhaps you should just explain at this point how it does work and how it's different.
Yes, and all other vacuum cleaners have paper bags or filters. And the problems with those is that they clog with dust very quickly. Mm-hmm. Normal vacuum cleaners are down to 1/3 their suction after about 5 minutes. This one separates the dirt from the air by cyclonic action, centrifugal force.
That sort of wall of death separation.
Exactly.
The dust out.
Yes. And the dust is collected down in this plastic container here. Mm-hmm. And you just empty that out.
So even though it was so much more efficient, British manufacturers didn't want to take it up, and I still don't really understand why. You say no bags, but I'd have thought that would be a tremendous bonus.
Well, yes, but it's a big marketing step. If you've been selling vacuum cleaners with paper bags for years, it's suddenly a huge jump to say, well, we don't need paper bags, all you use is the container.
And presumably somebody who's selling paper bags loses quite a lot of money.
Exactly. It's the resale.
So, I mean, you're now going to sell it. How? I mean, what's going to be your manufacturing outlet in this country? Is it going through the shops? How can we get hold of one of these wonderful machines?
It's initially being sold in England direct, door-to-door. Mm-hmm. And it lends itself quite nicely to that because it's terribly good on demonstrations.
Doesn't seem an ideal solution all the same. I think coming out of that discussion and also the fashion students was this problem of Britain as a place to be a designer in. Is that something you feel, that the climate is wrong here?
I think the British are very slow about taking up anything new, and they tend to wait for another country to do it first and then, you know, sort of either make it a success or a failure, and then they'll say, oh, well, if it's okay in Italy, it's fine here. And then they'll do it. So they're taking a sort of second step all the time, which is unfair to anybody trying to invent anything in England.
What do you think that we can do about that? I mean, should government be taking greater steps, do you think?
Yes, I think the government ought to be subsidising designers in far bigger way than they are. I mean, whether in fashion or invent whatever. And I also think that the media could help a lot more. I think newspapers and television should give it far more time than they do already.
Yes, it's remarkable actually how little coverage there is.
It's tiny.
And I wonder why that is. I mean, do you have any answer for that? Why we British seem to be so unvisual and so unconcerned about these nice things around us?
It beats me, because in Italy, every single designer show will somehow get on television. I mean, they actually film them all. And the newspapers run, you know, a story on a designer for a day during Fashion Week. In this country, you know, you're lucky if you get any coverage at all during Fashion Week, when it should be the most important time. It just doesn't cover it properly.
Mm-hmm. James, though, coming back to you, do you feel that the government should be doing more?
No, I think the designers should be doing more. Mm-hmm. I think they should be going out into industry and changing industry. They should be prepared to be salesmen and managing directors and not necessarily just designers. So I think that designers themselves are largely to blame. The government is certainly to blame by not providing easy and generous finance for new ideas. But and you see, companies themselves are to blame.
You see, I think if I was a company struggling through a recession, I would say, well, look, design is an optional extra.
It's never an optional extra. It's the most important thing. It's all the company has is their product, and the product has to be well designed. It's the most important thing.
And do you think it actually sells products? I think that's what I want you...
Absolutely. And that's proven. I'm not just talking about superficial skin design. I'm talking about the design of the product, the kind of thing that Which takes an interest in, as well as the kind of thing the Design Council takes an interest in.
Now, what about the great British public? I mean, do you think they're at fault? Do you think they're not demanding enough about the product, the sort of product they buy in the shops?
They've got no will to demand. No, it's not the public's fault. The public will buy what's put in the shops. The fault is with the shopkeepers not demanding things off manufacturers, and the fault is with the manufacturers not designing the right thing in the first place.
And presumably the only thing that will solve this is a growing awareness, and therefore something like this Barbican Young Blood exhibition is exactly what's needed.
Absolutely wonderful, yes. A lot more exhibitions like that, a lot more publicity for design and designers, and a lot more risk money to put into new products and new ideas.
Well, I must say, I'd thought of fashion and design as a rather glamorous business. Thank you, James Dyson, Arabella.
Yes, I think the government ought to be subsidising designers in far bigger way than they are. I mean, whether in fashion or invent whatever. And I also think that the media could help a lot more. I think newspapers and television should give it far more time than they do already.
Yes, it's remarkable actually how little coverage there is.
It's tiny.
And I wonder why that is. I mean, do you have any answer for that? Why we British seem to be so unvisual and so unconcerned about these nice things around us?
It beats me, because in Italy, every single designer show will somehow get on television. I mean, they actually film them all. And the newspapers run, you know, a story on a designer for a day during Fashion Week. In this country, you know, you're lucky if you get any coverage at all during Fashion Week, when it should be the most important time. It just doesn't cover it properly.
Mm-hmm. James, though, coming back to you, do you feel that the government should be doing more?
No, I think the designers should be doing more. Mm-hmm. I think they should be going out into industry and changing industry. They should be prepared to be salesmen and managing directors, and not and a number of other European companies. The English companies turned it down because it didn't have paper bags. And paper bags are a very lucrative source of income.
Perhaps you should just explain at this point how it does work and how it's different.
Yes, and all other vacuum cleaners have paper bags or filters. And the problems with those is that they clog with dust very quickly. Mm-hmm. Normal vacuum cleaners are down to one third their suction after about 5 minutes. This one separates the dirt from the air by cyclonic action, centrifugal force.
That sort of wall of death separation.
Exactly.
You fling
exactly,
the dust out.
Yes. And the dust is collected down in this plastic container here, mm-hmm. and you just empty that out.
So even though it was so much more efficient, British manufacturers didn't want to take it up, and I still don't really understand why. You say no bags, but I'd have thought that would be a tremendous bonus.
Well, yes, but it's a big marketing step. If you've been selling vacuum cleaners with paper bags for years, it's suddenly a huge jump to say, well, we don't need paper bags, all you use is... Well, the first problem was making it and developing it, and that took about 3 years of research and just simply working away and away and away, building model after model after model. And once I got the system to work, I then went around to manufacturers trying to sell the idea, because I didn't have the money to put the thing into production. And of course that took quite a long time. It took about 6 to 9 months.
You say you didn't have the money, but what sort of money is involved in securing the patents, putting it into production?
The patents are a relatively cheap part. We spent about £30,000 up front on the patents. But to put it into production costs about $500,000. That's just to get one made, to get it to this stage. That's before you start promoting it and selling it and so on. So it's a very heavy investment.
Now, I think I'm right in saying that you've actually persuaded an Italian manufacturer to put that into production. Did you not try and sell it here in Britain?
Oh, yes. I tried three British companies.
James, is that the same of commercial design? I mean, is it hard work that makes the difference between success and failure, do you think?
Oh, yes. It's all hard work.
I know you went round that exhibition at the Barbican and were impressed, as I was, by some of the exhibits, in particular, I think, that underground system.
Yes, that was very nice. He had thought that out very carefully. And he looked pretty determined to sell it, and that's important.
But tell me, what it's a very big step, isn't it, from having a good idea and even building a prototype to actually getting it in to manufacture. I mean, how big is that step and what does it take?
Well, the idea is about 0.5%. Making a prototype is about 3%, and getting it into production is the rest of it.
Now, I think I'm right in saying that you've just come up not only with that wonderful ball barrow, but also with a new invention, a vacuum cleaner, which I think we'll be able to see with a bit of luck quite shortly. And this is three times more effective than the conventional Hoover.
Yes.
But tell me about the problems you've had in actually getting this into production.
Is the container.
And presumably somebody who's selling paper bags loses quite a lot of money.
Exactly. It's the resale.
So, I mean, you're now going to sell it. How? I mean, what's going to be your manufacturing outlet in this country? Is it going through the shops? How can we get hold of one of these wonderful machines?
It's initially being sold in England direct, door-to-door. Mm-hmm. And it lends itself quite nicely to that because it's terribly good on demonstrations.
Doesn't seem an ideal solution all the same. I think coming out of that discussion and also the fashion students was this problem of Britain as a place to be a designer in. Is that something you feel, that the climate is wrong here?
I think the British are very slow about taking up anything new, and they tend to wait for another country to do it first and then, you know, sort of either make it a success or a failure, and then they'll say, oh, well, if it's okay in Italy, it's fine here, and then they'll do it. So they're taking a sort of second step all the time, which is unfair to anybody trying to invent anything in England.
What do you think that we can do about that? I mean, should government be taking greater steps, do you think?